Hi, I'm James Murphy. Have you ever come across an error when trying to import a module? In this case, it's telling me that I can't import my function A from a partially initialized module A. Scrolling over, it tells me that the most likely cause is a circular import. In this video, we'll go over how these circular imports commonly arise and what are the main ways to fix them. Here's the simplest and most common way that this kind of import cycle can happen. At runtime, main tried to import something from A, so it starts initializing A, it starts running the code from A. But the first line in A is to import something from module B. So it stops initializing A because B has to be initialized first, and then it hops over to B and starts running that code instead. But then the first line in B is that it needs something from A. So it stops running B and goes over to A, and it would like to just start initializing A, but it realizes that A is already in the process of initialization, so that's where the error occurs. We can actually see this chain of events unfold in the traceback. Here we see in main, it tries to import function A from module A, which triggered the import of function B from module B, which then triggered the import of function A again from module A, which is then where the final error occurred. The way that things are written right now, we have an import time cycle between the modules A and B. But if you actually look at the names that we imported, we don't actually use them at import time. We use them when this function A or when this function B2 are called. Since we're not actually calling these functions at import time, there's no true cyclic dependency, which means we can get rid of this import cycle. There are three common ways to resolve this issue. The first one is to take your import and put it inside of the function. In Python, imports can happen at any time, including when a function is called. So if this is the only place that you need this function B1, then it could be okay to just do the import right here. This could actually be even more efficient because if you never call the function A, then it may be that you never even have to import B at all. But let's say that you have a bunch of different functions in A and a lot of different ones use this function B1. In that case, the better solution would be to just import the module B directly. And then in the functions where you use it, use the longer name module B dot function B1. Go ahead and do this conversion for all modules involved in the cycle. Let's see how this resolves the import cycle at runtime. First, our main function tries to import something from A, causing A to start running. In A, we get to the import module B, which triggers B to start running. In B, when we get to the import module A, because the A module has already started initializing, this module object technically exists. Since it exists, it doesn't start running this again. It just says, okay, that exists. So the B module will just continue on, finish its import, and then after that import is done, the A module will finish importing. The third and final common way to get rid of this import cycle is to just merge the two modules together. No imports, no import cycles. However, if you had two or maybe even more modules in the first place, you probably had them for a reason. So I'm not just going to recommend that you take all of your modules and merge them into one. That would be kind of silly. So for that reason, you should probably prefer using one of the first two methods. Let's take a look at another example. The next most common kind of import cycle that you'll run into is due to using type hints. This example is not like the previous one because type annotations are defined on a function definition or a class definition when the function is defined, or when the class is defined, not when it's run. But if you think about it, the most common use case of type hinting is not even at runtime, it's for static type analyzers, like MyPy. If all we care about is static analysis, then we don't even need to do the import at runtime. The typing module provides this variable type checking, which is just false at runtime. So if you put all of the imports that you just need for the purpose of type checking in one of these if type checking checks, then none of those will actually happen at runtime, completely avoiding the import loop. But now if you import this function, you're going to get a name error because this name B hasn't been imported. To fix this, go ahead and add this from future import annotations. What this actually does is it changes the way that annotations work. Instead of evaluating B as a name, all annotations are converted to strings. So now you don't get an error at runtime here because even though the name B isn't imported, the string B certainly exists. You should be aware, though, that whenever you do one of these from future imports, it's not necessarily guaranteed behavior forever. Right now, this causes your annotations to be handled as strings, but there's actually a competing proposal to make them just be evaluated lazily, so they're just not evaluated at all unless you try to look at them. Unless you're actually inspecting your type hints at runtime, this probably won't make any difference for your codebase, but you should still be aware. An alternative solution is to, again, just use import modules instead of from module imports. You will still need the from future import annotations, and the downside to this approach is that your type hints look kind of, you know, not as nice. Now let's take a look at a very tricky cycle that some larger projects will run into. This is what I call the subpackage init cycle. The actual structure of the package is important for this example, so let's go over it. First, I have a main script. It's outside of the package and just tries to import some class from some module in the package and do whatever, very similar to the previous case. Now this package, my package, contains two subpackages, subpackage A and subpackage B. Subpackage A contains two modules, module A and C, and subpackage B contains the module B. For whatever reason, let's assume that module A needs something out of module B. Here's module B, which we also assume depends on module C. But looking at module C doesn't depend on anything, so there's no actual cycle here. A depends on B, and B depends on C. C doesn't depend on anything. Nevertheless, when we try to run it, we do get an import cycle. So what happened? The problem here is not with any of the modules A, B, or C. The actual issue is in these subpackage init files. Our subpackage init files here are re-exporting some names, in this case classes, from some of the modules inside of them. Doing this is pretty common in Python projects because it allows you to have shorter import syntax. Here, I can just have a client say from mypackage.subpackage A import A, instead of the longer from mypackage subpackage A module A import A. The problem with doing this is that every module in a subpackage depends on the init of the subpackage. So if the init of the subpackage depends on all of the modules in the subpackage, then you've kind of made a fake dependency of every module in the subpackage on every other module in the subpackage. That means even though C has no imports at all, C now automatically also depends on A because it depends on the init. Let's see this by starting in main and following the traceback. Main tries to import something from module B. So to import something from module B, we first have to run the subpackage init. All subpackage B does is import from module B, so we start importing module B. Module B wants to import something from module C, so first we have to initialize subpackage A that contains module C. But subpackage A imports from module A, and module A imports from module B, so now we have a cycle because we haven't finished initializing B. The way to get rid of this cycle is to just make all of your init files blank. If you still want to give your users a short way to import names rather than importing directly from the modules, you can define what I call an interface package. This is a package that has no extra modules, just its init. Inside the init, you put all of the things that you wanted to import from your other subpackage. Now your users can import from the interface instead of reaching directly into the modules, and there's still no import cycles. Depending on your use case, you might give the interface a separate name, but a lot of packages just make the true package that has all the modules in it underscore whatever, and then make the interface name just the whatever. So what was interface A just became subpackage A, and what was subpackage A became underscore subpackage A. Finally, let's take a look at the worst example. We're back to just a flat directory structure. We just have two modules, but in this case, both of the modules depend on each other. A depends on B, B depends on A, and they actually use those dependencies at import time. This is the worst and most difficult case, primarily because this often involves an architectural error. If you're actually using something from B in A, then that thing needs to be defined, so B needs to be initialized before A. But if you're also using something from A and B, then A needs to be initialized before B. Well, which one is it? Does B need to come before A, or does A need to come before B? In my experience, if your modules are that intertwined that they need each other both at import time, that kind of suggests to me that they should probably be the same module. Merging them together is your best bet. However, the most common case that I see this come up is when someone tries to mix library code with script code. Most commonly, these import time dependencies are not really necessary, and you should just pull them out into a script and leave the remaining library code alone. If you can't strip out these import time dependencies, then I'm sorry, there's not much I can do to help you. Your application needs some serious redesigning. It's going to be a mess no matter how you do it, and there's no general advice I can give you. Just good luck. As always, thank you for watching. Thank you to my patrons and donors for supporting me. Don't forget to subscribe, comment, and slap that like button an odd number of times. See you next time.